Okay, good evening, everyone. We're going to go ahead and get started. Welcome to everyone here on this very, very cold evening, and especially to the students on your day off. Thanks for getting out of the house and coming tonight. Hopefully you guys are well-rested for tomorrow. So I am Andrea Poore, and I'm one of the assistant principals here at Bishop Watterson, and I help with the College Credit Plus program, as well as our guidance department. We have the director of guidance here, which a lot of your questions will be answered by her tonight. Ms. Patty Creighton is here. We also have Mrs. Sponseller in the back from Guidance that's here tonight. And then we also have Jackie Jenkins. She is from Columbus State, and she is their director of College Credit Plus curricular program. So she is here with us tonight to answer questions, since we are excited to announce that we are partnering with Columbus State for next school year for college credit. So thank you for being here, and before we get started, we're going to go ahead and start with prayer, as we do with all things here at Watterson. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Almighty God, we thank you for bringing us all here this evening to talk about this very exciting program here at Watterson. We ask that you be with all those who are suffering in mind, body, and spirit, especially during these cold winter months, and we ask you to be with anyone who is suffering during this time. And let us pray. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. So for those of you who have who are veteran parents of Watterson, who have had students go through the dual enrollment process in the past, the College Credit Plus program has evolved quite a bit, and so that's why we're having this informational session tonight, to explain to you the differences and how it has evolved to what it is today. In the past, you'll remember that dual enrollment used to be, we had a partnership with Ohio Dominican University for many years, probably back since the early 2000s. And that program was wonderful. We had a lot of students that went through that program. And basically, the difference is that those classes were combined with our AP program. And so if you took an AP course, a lot of the time it would also, you could apply for it to be also college credit. You could choose one or the other, but it would be the same class. So you would take a class for the entire year, and it would either be for the AP credit or for college credit. And so a lot of our students were able to do that, and a lot of them were already going to take it at the AP level, and so then they could then choose to have it as both enrollment here at Watterson and enrollment at Ohio Dominican. Last fall, which happened to be my first year here as an administrator, Ohio Dominican shocked all of the Catholic schools who had a partnership with them, and they basically told us at a meeting last fall that they were actually not going to do the College Credit Plus program anymore. From what we understand, it was not a financial benefit for Ohio Dominican. That was one of the big reasons. And we've been talking with their new president to talk about ways in which maybe later on they may pick that back up. But for right now, the Catholic schools were kind of left to our own decision as to what we were going to do. So last year was a big, big planning year for Watterson and for the other Catholic schools as well to figure out what we wanted to do. And we ended up partnering with Jackie, who is an alum of Watterson as well. And she understands our program very, very much. And we're excited to partner again with Columbus State. What we're going to talk about tonight, though, you're going to notice the differences. So if you've gone through this before of what it used to be known as dual enrollment and College Credit Plus, you'll see the differences. One of the main differences is that we are not able anymore to have it embedded in the AP program. Okay, so if you take an AP class, that's going to be just an AP class. It cannot count anymore as dual enrollment, and that is by law. Okay, so that's not our decision, that is the new program. The other difference that you'll see is when it used to be dual enrollment, you could take it, as I said, a normal class for the entire year. Now, college credit is really meant to be a college class, which, as you know, college classes are semester classes. So that is a new thing for us for next year. So if you're taking a College Credit Plus class, it is going to be over a semester long time, okay? So that's a 3-credit-hour class during a semester, which is obviously a lot more rigorous, and it's a lot different than it would be if it was an entire year. Okay, so Ms. Creighton will also kind of talk about, well, if you take a science course, okay, that's going to count as a 3-credit for college, and it also will be your credit for high school for one of your science credits, what do you do the other semester? Okay, because our science classes now here at Waterston are a full-year class. Okay, so that's a big difference. Okay, so that kind of gives you a little bit of the background and the history and a little bit of what the new changes are. So at this time, I'm going to go ahead and introduce Ms. Creighton, and she will continue.
Thank you. So what is College Credit Plus? It is a law that took effect in 2015-16 that replaced post-secondary option and also dual enrollment. So now it's all under the umbrella of College Credit Plus. It says that students who are college eligible or college ready in grades 7 through 12 can take college classes and have them count as college credit as well as high school credit. So students in grades 7 through 12 have to be eligible for the program, and this law keeps changing and keep adding components to it. So this year they've added they have to have some sort of assessment to show that they are college ready. They may apply to any public or private schools that they want to, as long as they fulfill that requirement and are eligible for it. And they can do a variety of schools, a variety of subjects. Could be online, it could be at the high school level, and it could be on the college campus as well. And you must be an Ohio resident to do that as well, your participating program. So I said it counts as, Mrs. Poore said the same thing, it counts as high school credit and college credit. So as long as it's a 3-credit or more college credit, it counts towards 1 credit of high school. So we're talking about those semester classes. You can take a semester of a 3-credit class, and it counts as 1 high school credit with that. And again, they've changed the law again, and you can take classes during the summertime now, which took effect this past year. So summertime, the fall, and also in the spring, you can take those classes. There is a maximum that a student can take per year. So if a student wanted to take a class in the summertime, you would do this little equation, possible 30 credits. You have to take out the high school credits that are part of that. So if a student took 7 credits throughout the year, 7 times 3 is 21, 21 minus 30 is 9. So the students could take up to 9 credits, college credits at that. They can't take above that. Take above it, then they would have to pay out of pocket for those. And they wouldn't have the benefits of College Credit Plus. And I'll go through some of the benefits as we go along. So for next school year, we're working on the following classes through Columbus State. So there is American History. There's 2 parts, up to 1877 and then after 1877. So a student could take a semester of each of those, and that would count towards their history credit. They can do a fundamental human anatomy and physiology class. So that's a semester of that as well. And that class would run through that to account as a credit of science with that. We're going to try and see how this works, doing an intro to organic chemistry and general chemistry. And this class, if you notice, is a 5-credit class. That is because it incorporates a lab with it. And it would be a 2-hour lab. So for all these classes, I want you to think about them as Ms. Poore said, they're not embedded anymore. These are Columbus State classes taught at Bishop Waterston. So we're following their schedule, we're following their timeline, we're following the days of the week that the classes are supposed to be taught, and we're following the days that we have to have labs with them. So they have a requirement, maybe 2-hour lab. So if a student wants to take the chemistry class, then we are going to try to hook their study hall next to their chemistry class so that on one day a week, they're going to be going to lab during that time. There is a personal finance class, and this one will count towards the graduation requirement of financial literacy. So this past year we had financial literacy, we also had honors principles of financial planning. Next year the honors principles of financial planning will no longer be there. It'll be you take the financial literacy class or you take the College Credit Plus class. We are trying to get a medical terminology class approved. So that's in the process of being looked at. The break going on right now, there's just a lot of time that people put out. So hopefully they'll get back soon and give us an answer on that. I almost did not put the marketing one on here because I'm not quite sure how we're going to handle that. We'll do that. So we're waiting to hear back on that. And we'll see how we can incorporate that into our curriculum with that. So these are the classes that we'll be offering next year. We are also going to ask, and this is different, that you let us know which classes you're going to take. Because you can take them at Waterslip, you can take them online, you can take them on college campus, you can take them during the summertime. So we want notification of which ones you're going to take through College Credit Plus. So there is a form, it's actually the last page of that packet. And it asks you to make sure that you read through and been at this meeting, heard the risks and the benefits of the program, to sign off on a couple things, and to also know that if you do not go through the whole process of getting the funding for the College Credit Plus class, then you do not get the benefits of College Credit Plus. Now remember I said to participate, the student must take some sort of assessment. This gives you an idea of the different types of assessments that are there. There's an ACT or SAT. There's AccuPlacer, Alex, PlaceU, and MapleSoft. So there's a lot of different ones that are out there. You would check with the college you're going to participate with and see what type of assessment they would like you to do. If you're thinking about Ohio State likes an ACT or SAT. If you're going to do their program, some of those dates are showing up in March for their deadline. So you need to have that ACT or SAT taken so that you can get that into them on time to meet that deadline with them. Columbus State does the AccuPlacer and the Alex as well.
And we also accept ACT and SAT.
And ACT and SAT as well. Okay. If a student does not meet the criteria, there is a loophole that they have above a 3.0 and they get a letter of recommendation, they can still get eligibility that way. So I don't think our students have a problem with that. The second step in participating. A student must apply for admission, contact the admissions of the college to learn about their process, paperwork, and deadlines. You must follow their deadlines to get things turned in on time. And they have the final decision on admissions. Step three is to consider eligibility, attend the university, and discuss the options. What type of classes can you take through the college? And you would work with the college, you're going to have a college advisor and you have your high school counselor. So the college advisor would help you choose which courses best fit your goals and your placement. The high school counselor will help you figure out which classes you can substitute, high school classes you can substitute, if any at all. Grades will be factored into your high school and college GPA. So for this, and this is by law as well, in the subject area, that College Credit Plus class, what is the highest level of, I guess, credit you can get for that? So like for business, if you take the personal finance class, our business department also has AP microeconomics and AP macroeconomics, and that gets a 0.5 bump. So that means if you take that personal finance class through College Credit Plus, it must also get a 0.5 bump. So whatever content area you take that class, whatever the highest level that we offer at high school is the same type of bump that the student will get. That makes sense. But you also have to be aware that if you're going to substitute some classes, that the students are still taking the end of course test. Remember they have to hit that state 18 points for that? So they're still taking those end of course exams for those. So they're not getting out of that. How many can the students take? If they apply for funding, you'll get the funding back, and I'll let you know how many courses are paid for through College Credit Plus. Again, they can still take more than that, but if you do that, it would be through self-pay. All right, how do you apply for funding? Because they do keep changing things a little bit as they go along here, you always want to probably keep checking on the Ohio Department of Education's website. For the list, so this gives you the website, and this is for non-public students. They do have a step-by-step process there. I'm pretty sure we're up to date on everything with this, but every once in a while, you should check to make sure that that's the case. They open up the application process on February 8th, and they close it at April 13th. So there's a series of steps you need to go through to make it through all this. And that is on the second to the last page. We're going to talk a lot about steps along the way, but we broke it down to, if you follow down through that list, follow those steps, you should be pretty good shape. So just to review this a little bit, to apply for funding, you go to the website, you must set up what's called a SAFE account. You can do that at any time. Once you have a SAFE account, you follow the online directions for requesting access to College Credit Plus funding. You go through the funding application process, make sure everything complete and submitted. You must have the admissions that you made it, you were admitted into the college, that you wouldn't take the College Credit Plus. You have to have that letter to submit for this, for the funding. So make sure you're ahead of the game on applying to those schools. A few weeks after you apply, you should receive notification, the award letter. And as you see the award letter, you download it into your, from your SAFE account, and you also must provide that to the college. This bottom part is just saying if you choose to register before funding and you don't get the funding for the class, you have the option of either self-paying or you can drop the class.
Okay, so one thing to consider, obviously this is a fantastic program, and I know that that's, a lot of you are here tonight because you're thinking, well, this is great. We can get some college classes paid for before we even get into college. And that is obviously the bonus of this program, and it's wonderful. But there are some things to consider, and Mrs. Creighton and I have been to many College Credit Plus meetings over the last couple years. And one thing that they talk about is, is your student ready for a college class? Okay, one thing to really think about is the fact that your students are in high school. And high school is, by itself, its own experience, okay? College is its own experience. And everyone in this room who has been to college knows that that is a very different experience than high school. And so this program is not meant to, you know, to take away anything and to make sure that, you know, I guess what they've been telling us is don't think that you're going to get half your college credit done, okay? You and I both know that your students, you want to have that four-year college experience. But if you can jump on it a little bit and get some of that paid for, that is a great thing to do. But what we want to do tonight is really have you just think about whether or not your students are ready for this, okay? So just a couple things to think about. What is the difference between a high school and a college class? In high school, tests are sometimes given weekly or at the end of each chapter. College classes are not that way. Okay, you know, you will have tests along the way, but you're going to have a lot fewer tests, a lot fewer quizzes, and the homework that you're going to have is not necessarily going to apply or be applied to your final grade. Okay, college is a lot different. Study time. High school. Required homework ranges between 1 to 3 hours per day per class, okay, especially here at Watterson. For college, the standard rule is 2 to 3 hours of homework for every hour spent in class, which means 3 to 5 hours, okay, per day. Knowledge acquisition. In high school, information is provided mostly in class. The teachers are teaching every single day, and they're giving you the information that you need to then do well on the assessment that they give. In college, most of the work is going to be on the student, outside work, outside research. Okay, so it's not going to be, as our teachers, a lot of them do, you know, giving the information every single day. This is more of it being on the student to actually do the research outside of class. In high school, numerous quizzes, tests, and homework, as I said. Fewer tests, if any, for a college credit class. Homework assignments will not be used to determine final grades. It's more of a midterm exam and a final exam. Okay, and that's something that our students are not very prepared for if they've never had this experience. Parent roles. In high school, parents are obviously, you guys are very strong advocates for your students. We administrators hear from you on a daily basis sometimes. The guidance counselors are very much involved in that. Some of that will still take place with the counselors, okay, to help your students through. It is a Bishop Watterson class as well as a college credit class. But the parent in a college class serves as the
first deadline. But if you wait, you may not have your acceptance letter in time that's required for the state to participate. So again, those deadlines are in the handouts. And then taking the placement test, we do accept ACT and SATs. If basically you need an English 490 as a benchmark, if you have below that, then you would have to take the AccuPlacer. If you have the reading or the writing for 90 and the SAT, you're set. If you have an 18 in English on the ACT, you're set. Okay. So the other thing is, we have acceptance into the college, and then we also then have prerequisites that the students need to meet. So sometimes a student gets accepted to the college, and then they're trying to take, let's just say, calculus, but they haven't even taken the AccuPlacer yet. We would have to test that student, look at an ACT score, or test you on the ALEKS to qualify for a math, because math is not a requirement to get into Columbus State from a College Credit Plus perspective. Yes, I have a question.
What about PSAT scores?
We do not accept PSAT scores. It's got to, if the student has not taken the ACT, that is not a problem at all. We have seventh graders taking the AccuPlacer and ALEKS. All right, so as far as registering for classes, we make this really easy for the student. Sometimes almost too easy, because I think they almost are so inactive in the process that they don't even actually sometimes know that they're enrolled in the class, because we work with the guidance office in getting the students registered for those who are taking the classes at Waterson. So we work with the guidance and we send rosters through a SharePoint portal that's completely confidential back and forth. It's a way that we talk back and forth with each other. So the guidance will know if your student is wanting to participate, if your child is wanting to participate in one of those classes being held here. And then it's a different process if you're going to take a class at Columbus State or online. All right, so then if you want to take a class online or at Columbus State, we have, as was mentioned earlier, we have an advisor that is assigned to Waterson students. Her name is Jordan Wilson, and she would work with your student, or those of you who are students, work with you, and selecting those classes that are going to fulfill your career goals. Like if you know kind of where you're wanting to go, that helps a lot. If you don't really know what you want to do or where you want to go, we'll probably keep you in the arts and science courses, and those are the ones that transfer to any four-year school in the state of Ohio. So that's normally kind of the best route to go if a student really does not know what they want to do. We have a form that's completed. It's signed by the parent, it's signed by the student, and it's signed by the guidance. So that way we all have an understanding of what class is being taken online or at one of the Columbus State locations. All right, so there's a couple things that I want to discuss to you before I give it back over. Number one, it's an exciting time. It really is an exciting time. And I think American students have not been challenged. And this is a great way. It's so obvious. Our students are doing fabulous in these courses. We have over a 90% success rate of these students taking College Credit Plus courses. The College Credit Plus students are blowing our traditional students out of the water as far as assessments are going. So it's great. So really, you need to think about it. You need to talk about it at home. So let's just say, especially if you're going to take a class online or on campus, it wouldn't be unusual for, you have an 18-year-old daughter, it would be unusual for your daughter to walk into a 6 p.m. class and have a 55-year-old male, a 25-year-old male, 35-year-old woman with four kids, 18-year-old, and a 16-year-old. That would be kind of, could be a very, very typical
class size, and that might be who within your daughter or son's study group. So that's the reality. You have to think about that, and you have to talk about that at home. Is my son or daughter ready to have mature conversations with a group like that if they're thinking about going? I mean, that's really anywhere. That would be the Ohio State University or Kenyon or Columbus State. So those are the serious conversations you have to have. Believe it or not, some of our students do great. I was at Big Walnut, and this little eighth grader came over. He was probably not much taller than I was, and had his braces, eighth grade, and he blew me away. He was excited about an intro to psych class. He was ready to talk about it. He was very mature. And I was like, he's gonna do great. He's ready. But if your son or daughter's not one to talk for themselves, they look at you to talk and that kind of thing, that's first thing, have them go off and have them apply on their own and see how they do. How do they do? Talking on the phone with the administrators and that type of thing, because that's part of the experience. But it's great. It would be a great experience for all the students. And again, as Andrea said, she made such a good point. Your student might necessarily be a year ahead of the degree, but it might also give your student that senior year an opportunity to study abroad, or maybe study another major, because they're done with their major requirements, but they're not done in college. They still want to have an experience. This gives them that fourth year to do something really cool as a senior in college. So that's another great opportunity. And the one thing I want to leave that I think is really, really important is, as far as the funding, I would say the funding is higher as your student is in class rank. So a lot of times those seniors get the most funding, and then the juniors get a little less, the sophomores get a little less, and sometimes we'll see the letters from the state and there's no funding. Keep in mind, we have a great opportunity for those of you who are taking the classes at Waterson. Within the embedded classes, you will be charged what the others are being charged from a state perspective. So for instance, let's just say an average class is about $402. We're gonna charge you $402 whether you got funding or not. And that's for the embedded classes. Now if you're to go to Columbus State or take an online class, unfortunately, we don't have the fee waiver. So it's a way to kind of give those parents a break who just didn't get the funding. So even though you don't get the funding, definitely talk to Patty, because we'll kind of give you an idea of what you're gonna owe. Okay, so I wanted to give you that information. And then one more thing, one of the benefits of Columbus State, we have an early alert process. So there should be no reason a student gets through the entire class with an E. Normally that faculty member has an opportunity and is really, really encouraged to contact, it's an early alert to say, hey, this student has missed 5 classes. This student has failed 3 tests, and it gets Columbus State in conversations with guidance to see what's going on, to see if we need to get the student withdrawn. So again, we have, as was mentioned in the PowerPoint, we have writing centers, we have free tutoring when the classes are on the web. So if there's Blackboard, there's free tutoring, lots of activities, lots of services. So again, it'll be between Jordan and I who will be working with you over the next year, and I'm here to answer any questions. This is, again, Jordan's information. I'm Jackie Jenkins. I'm in the directory. Call me anytime if you have questions, and thanks for letting me be here tonight in my alma mater.
For the students who have taken ACT or SAT, this AccuPlacer. Is that an online test, or is that done here?
So, are you being trained to take to
they're gonna go. So they just go to campus. It's basically, we have testing center open from approximately 8 o'clock to 7 p.m.
Anytime.
Pretty much almost anytime. That information is on our website.
One-hour test, four-hour test?
It's about 2.5, the reading and writing together. And then if the student is wanting to take the science class, they need to do the ALEKS, which is math. The ALEKS, which is a math test. And I'm sure, like this, as students are bringing in their intent to participate, the guidance will be working with you in what the student should take.
Woody did classes last summer with Oklahoma State, so she's in the system, right?
Yes.
She has her SAFE account, we won't be doing any of that, and she's already, do we have to do the placement again?
That she is bringing up a really, really good point, thank you. So if you are returning, whether you are returning at Columbus State, or you're returning at The Ohio State University, or Kenyon, or OU, or any other college through College Credit Plus, you need to also send a letter of good standing with your acceptance letter. So we will provide kind of another acceptance that, yeah, you've been accepted into the program, and you're also in good standing. So we will do that for you. So those who are returning, work with Jordan, and we'll make sure that you get that letter of good standing.
So just send it. Do you need to place it again?
No.
No, we're not.
Unless you have not done, it would depend on your ACT score. Like, are you going to do the chemistry, possibly? No. Physics? No, you probably don't need testing. Any other questions? Yes?
Is the program also available to, international students?
It is. So basically, there will be a series of questions that we would ask. It really pretty much follows the procedures for a student who is an international student at Columbus State. So if you are on a visa status that allows you to be reclassified as an Ohio resident, then absolutely. If normally a visitor, it does not qualify. But like, if your parent is on like a working visa, like an H visa, and you are an H-4, yes, you would just have to submit additional information to become qualified. We just have to show that you you're being taxed as an Ohio resident, because Ohio residents have, it's only eligible for Ohio residents. Does that make sense? So when you apply to the college, just answer those questions, because it's going to ask you, are you a U.S. citizen? If you're not, then you say no. And then it will come and it will ask you, do you have a visa status? And then that's where you put the visa status. Then we'll have a series of questions we'll ask you through email. So it's really important that you read your emails from us once you book that.
Okay.
Sure. There was someone, yeah.
Will there be other classes offered besides the ones that are listed?
So this is what we have planned for the 18-19 school year for the embedded classes at Bishop Watterson. This was a great place to start. I don't know if it, you know, there would be discussions for later on, but in conjunction with your students' guidance counselor or your school counselor, you know, we've got online classes. We have classes that start as early as 7 and end as late as 11 p.m. So you can also supplement taking classes on campus or online.
So those on-site classes, I'm assuming they would have to be in the evening, right? I mean, how would that work with their schedule in their normal day?
We have a lot of students that are actually taking classes in some type of program at one of our extended campuses and then going back to their high school in like the afternoon. Hilliard is a perfect example. We have a program at Accelerated Learning Center where the students take classes in a pathway during the day and then they return to their home school in the afternoon. So again, this would be, it takes a lot of planning, but, and it would be the permission of
the school guidance and administration to allow your student to do that. But we have a lot of students. We actually have a lot of seniors that are taking college credit plus classes full time practically. They've exhausted all of their high school requirements. I think, I don't know, we may have up to 5 or 6 graduates now that are graduating with a high school diploma at the same time they're graduating with a Columbus State Associate's degree. It's pretty amazing. We have smart kids. We really do. Really, really smart kids. It's exciting though.
Let me just add on to that too. The courses that you see for next school year,
we are hoping to grow this program. And so next year will be kind of our foundational year again to get back into this. So those courses though are here on campus. They're taught by our teachers. So you can see a list of those in the curriculum guide that'll be out in the coming weeks. And just so you know, those teachers have to go through a credentialing process with Columbus State. So they have been credentialed. They have to have a master's in that actual field, which many of our teachers have a master's in administration or a master's in education or whatever the master's may be. These teachers have master's in the actual content area that they're teaching, which is required by the colleges. Okay, so we are kind of limited on how many teachers can teach courses. And so these teachers, they actually taught, most of them, in the dual enrollment program before with Ohio Dominican as well. So they're very much experienced in the college atmosphere, and they know the process really well. But what we need from you guys also, you have to understand that at Waterston, we can't necessarily have a class that, let's say, only one student signs up for the chemistry class. That's not very feasible for us at Waterston. Our teachers already have a jam-packed schedule. So what we need from you guys, we're going to be promoting this through guidance within the classrooms. But those of you who are interested in these courses, we kind of need you to go ahead and advertise, especially you students, to your friends. Hey, did you guys know about this College Credit Plus program? I was at this information session. Go down and talk to your guidance counselor or talk to these teachers. Okay, so like Dr. Nicolosi and Mr. Zeller and Mrs. Cook and these teachers who are going to be teaching these, encourage your classmates to sign up, okay, so that we do have a viable class for next year. That's what happened this year. We didn't have enough students that signed up for those classes. So now that we have this in place, we really do want to have several students taking these, and then we can grow the program from there. Okay? So usually it's a 10 student minimum. I'm not saying that that's definite for this year. You know, if it's 7 or 8 kids, you know, we will definitely have these courses. But we do need kids to sign, or students to sign up. So make sure and talk it up with your classmates and parents, you as well. So it's a small group here tonight. We're going to have this video on the website, so hopefully a lot of people will view it. But it's very important that we get this going so we can continue to grow this program.
Yes. Waterston is incredibly lucky. You have 2 science faculty here that were already adjuncts at Columbus State. I mean, they're already teaching at Columbus State. So that's
Mr. Hansen and Dr. Nicholson.
Yeah, I mean, that is really unique. I mean, our lead faculty already knew your teachers. And it was like, yeah. He definitely is fine. He's our adjunct. He barely has to go through a credentialing. He's already teaching these classes for our traditional students. So again, you're very, very fortunate. Very fortunate.
Any last minute questions? Yes.
Maybe I missed it, but the embedded classes are during the day?
Are during the school day. Okay. So it will be, so instead of your child taking their normal science class, their sophomore or junior year, they would sign up for the chemistry class or the physics class, whatever the class might be for College Credit Plus. And so that student is going to take that chemistry class within 1 semester. It counts as 3 credits for the college, and it counts as 1 science credit for here. So in other words, you don't need that full year of science anymore. You're getting it within a semester. So then you're going to work with your guidance counselor to figure out what you're going to take second semester, since you're not going to be taking science. Okay? You would take an elective of some sort, or maybe you put in your study hall then, whatever the case might be. Now, those of you who are thinking about that chemistry with that lab, you're going to have chemistry, and then you're going to have study hall back to back. Because 2 days a week in that study hall, you will be going to lab. Okay? And then you'd have your science the period before, the period after, every single day. And you have to think about
that may lock your schedule up for other things that you want to take, okay? Such as things that are only offered, like band, eighth period, or choir, or theater, or whatever the case might be. So you have to kind of think.